specifically counting on to make this key measurement are located in Arizona and New Mexico for the United States, also in Chile and Texas and Spain and South Africa and Australia and Israel. And these are the ones that we officially have on there, but we are welcoming anyone and everyone to, in order to help like make these measurements around the world. Goldstone Solar System Radar has already signed up. Hubble Space Telescope is going to give a look and see what they can see. James Webb Space Telescope is actually planning, once their commissioning is done, to take a look. Maybe they'll be able to get some pictures of the ejecta that happens with the event. And just other ones around the world are continuing to line up. So in the next month or two, we'll have a really great list of all these major observatories around the world. Planetary defense really is an international concern. We're all on this planet together. And so we really welcome these international contributions for the DART mission. I'm glad I included this because it sounds like you guys have a lot of abilities here. These telescopes that we're using are on the larger side in order to do this brightness measurement, but Didymos itself is actually going to be minimized the distance between it and Earth. And so this is just one example of where it's going to be passing through the sky, starting sort of in August of 2022 through January, with different magnitudes shown there. And with an 8-inch telescope, people don't think you'd see it through an eyepiece, but if you did have a CCD or some other camera set up, you'd be able to see it. And obviously, fancier setups than that, you should be able to detect it. So not saying that you'll be able to see a lot of stuff necessarily on September 26th, but you might be looking up and at least know what's going on. So one of the main criteria that we want to do this mission for is also do it on a real asteroid of a relevant size for planetary defense, not just a lab scale or something. And that's because one of the main things we want to do is this momentum enhancement factor, beta. So a beta of 1 would mean you get no momentum enhancement. That means like your spacecraft comes in, you nudge the asteroid, that's how much you change it by. This is kind of like billiard balls or something like that. Nobody thinks this is what's going to happen. Instead, everybody fully expects that there's going to be ejecta. Now, the thing about ejecta, rock and debris being thrown off during the collision of the DART spacecraft, is it's like a jet that gives you an extra push in the opposite direction. And if there's a lot of ejecta, for example, then you would get an even bigger push. From spacecraft that have visited asteroids before, we know that they are made out of a variety of material, that they might not be as strong as some other materials. So they might be weaker and they might have a lot of extra ejecta. So doing this on an asteroid that's of the relevant size is one of the main focuses for DART, and determining how much of this momentum enhancement factor you really get is also a key measurement. So I've talked a lot about our team members who are going to be at telescopes and be using the telescopic data, and about DRACO and using the DRACO images in order to understand the geology and the shape and the impact site. But we also have a really strong team who is going to be doing a bunch of modeling using state-of-the-art robust codes in order to model what this impact event looks like. And this just shows some of the models that they've run for different materials. So the one that's labeled no porosity, for example, would be like your granite countertop. And this is the sort of material that you would get if you crashed into something like that. The microporosity would be like a pumice or like a lava, fluffy lava sort of rock, still hard. You can see you're going to get a different crater shape, a different amount of ejecta. Now, a lot of what we think with asteroids is they're actually these rubble piles. They're made up of a bunch of rocks that are all just kind of sitting next to each other, small ones and big ones. How strong they are put together is one of the main things we don't know. And you can see you get very interesting things to happen in these collisions when they do. So there'll be a lot of modeling work that takes the DRACO images, sees where you hit, puts that into these state-of-the-art modeling codes in order to be able to understand this, because again, DART is just a test. It's a technology demonstration. We want to learn from DART so that we can apply it to other things in the future if we needed to. So it's very important to understand what happens with DART so that we can apply this to many other situations in the future, and not just this asteroid in itself. It's really important to also take that step back again and talk about how planetary defense is a much larger strategy, of which DART is just one part. It does not make sense to just do DART on its own. Planetary defense is much more than just crashing things into asteroids. You can't do anything about the asteroids if you don't know where they are. So the foundation of planetary defense has got to be searching, detecting, and tracking them. And then you want to characterize them. You want to understand what they're made out of, the different materials, how they're put together. Planning and coordination is a big part of the strategy as well. And those acronyms down there are some committees that are at the United Nations level, for example, where they're international committees, international groups that have a planning network for if these things would happen. And you want to constantly be assessing. Like I said, right now, out of everything that we're tracking and have detected, we're assessing it and modeling it for 100 years. And none of those are a threat to hit the Earth for the foreseeable future. But you want to continually be doing that. And then there's mitigate. And that's where DART comes in. DART is the first mission that's being that was launched and flown specifically for NASA's Planetary Defense Coordination Office, which is an office that was only established at NASA in 2016. And so this is their first dedicated flight project with DART, but it won't be the last. And this is just the mitigate part of this. If you need to do something about it, let's have the technologies ready so that we can. I also mentioned it's an international issue and we have international cooperation. This is actually one of the pillars of the national strategy as well. The DART mission is going to intercept Dimorphos in 2022, September 26th of 2022, but there's also the Hera mission. So the Hera mission is run by the European Space Agency and it's going to launch in 2024 and it's going to rendezvous with the Didymos Dimorphos system in 2026. And so it will not just fly by it, it will actually stay there for 6 months or longer, and it will make really important measurements such as the mass of Dimorphos. When we come in with Draco, we will be able to get its shape, but we won't actually be able to measure its mass. So we won't be able, we'll have to make some assumptions about its density. When Hera gets there and is orbiting and rendezvous, we'll get a really good measurement on that mass, which will be very helpful. Hera will also be able to see the crater made by DART. And that crater, the models show that that crater will be very different depending on how strong the asteroid was. So going and inspecting the crater made by DART for Hera is going to be very insightful. And this is just a more details a little bit about how DART and Hera, you know, are working together as planetary defenders with this international cooperation. With DART is a very straightforward mission. It has an optical camera on it and Lychia cube. And in 2022, we'll have this collision. And then in Hera will launch in 2024. And it's got two CubeSats on it, actually, that's going to have to get the mineralogy and gather radar data. Hera has a more extensive payload because they're not just slamming and crashing into an asteroid, but actually orbiting around for a while. Multiple optical cameras, a thermal infrared imager contributed by the Japanese Space Agency, a hyperspectral imager, and a LIDAR. And so really working together, this gives more than either mission could just accomplish on its own. So just wanted to end with a few things about how you can continue to follow DART. We have a great website that's there, the dart.jhuapl.edu. You can become a planetary defender. There's a little quiz online. You can take it, other people can take it. And if you pass, which I've passed, then you get a little badge. So definitely encourage you to go do that. We've had tens of thousands of people do this. We're on Twitter, we're on Facebook, Instagram, hashtag DART mission, hashtag planetary defense are good ways for that. We've got some fun things on our website as well. There's 3D printable models, so you can print your own DART spacecraft and crash it if you want to, I suppose. Mm-hmm. Or you can print the asteroids, Didymos and Dimorphos. Dimorphos is just represented by this little oval now, but after September, when we get a good shape model, we'll load that onto the website too, and you can update your model with the real shape of Dimorphos. But for right now, you can print out the models sort of the same way that we're using them. We have a You can make a toy bricks model, sort of like Legos. We've got that there. And there's this augmented reality experience, which that's me at the launch site with the DART still on the ground and that rocket behind me and the fake spacecraft over my head. So that QR code will take you to that augmented reality experience, or go to our website there under Outreach. So cool. And here you go, September 26th. is put it on your calendars. It's a Monday night, 7:14 p.m. It's going to be a smashing good time. So. Gotta use it, gotta embrace it. So anyways, I'm happy to take questions, and yeah, thanks.
Well, I see one over on YouTube here. We'll just kind of start that off. We'll see if we get some more questions in. But Stephen Trier had asked earlier, he's watching from Kalamazoo, Michigan today. And he says in Oakland, California, there's a Chabot Space and Science Center, and wondering if you have anything to do with that.
Yeah, I am not related to them or have anything to do with it that I know of. I hear it's fabulous, though, from a lot of my friends who live in the area. So I feel like they should invite me to go visit or something, but yeah. Maybe I should reach out to them. So anyways, if you have any contacts, go ahead, you know, tell them I want an invitation. But no, I'm not not related, but it is a really pretty well-known space science center.
Mm-hmm. Abby Sheridan also asked from YouTube tonight, if DART hits the target and nudges it off its current course, is the new course without impact possible? Is there a chance that something could happen with that new course that the asteroid is on?
Yeah, so that's what really why this is also using this double asteroid system is such a good way to do this first test, because Didymos is so much bigger than Dimorphos. It's 780 meters, the size of skyscrapers, right? You know, and you have this little great pyramid that goes around it. And what DART is doing, which again is like a golf cart slamming into the Great Pyramids, is just giving it a small nudge. And so it gives it this small little nudge, and it only is going to orbit about 1% closer to the much larger Didymos than it used to. So it's only knocking the moon ever so slightly closer than it used to be to a much larger asteroid, both of which just continue to travel around the sun and are really not affected at all in their path. And so we're even knocking the moon like more stably bound to the larger asteroid than it used to be with this DART test. So this is a great way to do this first test. If you wanted to do this in the future because you needed to, it would work sort of the same way, except you would hit something, you know, the same sort of thing, you know, it'd still be a much smaller spacecraft into a larger asteroid, but you just give it a small nudge, and then this adds up to a bigger change with time. So if you wanted to do something like DART, you should do it 5, 10, 15, 20 years in advance. Small nudge, lots of time, then the Earth and the asteroid wouldn't be on a future collision course. And so this really is meant to be as controlled as much as you can, not making your problem more complicated, just a small nudge. In this case, it's just making that moon orbit a bit closer to the much larger asteroid, but no danger whatsoever for knocking things on some other course that would be a danger to the Earth.
Good to know. Joe in the Zoom webinar asked a question here too. So when you strike the asteroid, is it imperative where you strike it? So say you hit it on the side, if you hit it in the middle, is any impact acceptable? Is it doesn't matter where you hit it as long as you get a result, right?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So we're purposely trying to hit Dimorphos sort of when it is at this maximum elongated, as nearly head on as possible, if you will, right? So that, you know, all of the momentum that DART is bringing in goes into kind of hitting this thing head on. That's to maximize the deflection. And so that timing is picked for that reason. The deflection will also be maximized if you try to hit it as nearly as center as possible. The way the camera SmartNav is using, it's an optical camera though. And so there's going to be some part of this asteroid that's in shadow and some part that's not, that's going to depend on the topography. So it's going to be the optical center that it's guiding on, which might not be the same as the actual center of mass. So we've done a lot of simulations of a lot of different shadings and a lot of different ways it might hit or how well SmartNav will work. And our requirement actually is to make a change that's 73 seconds big. Now we think it's going to be more like 10 minutes or more. So we're very safely within this 73 seconds, which is measuring it to a precision of 7.3 seconds. It sort of gets to like what the telescopes can do in a very precise sort of way. And it turns out that even if you don't hit it head on, or you do a grazing impact, or you do all of these things in these models that we've done, all of the deflection from those are always greater than the 73 second requirement. So we expect that we will easily surpass this, that it's going to be 10 plus minutes. Even if it doesn't hit it quite as head on or quite as the square, anything that hits is going to deflect it enough that we'll be able to measure it and it'll be a success. So yeah, it's hitting it is a success, but also deflecting it enough so you can measure it and see how much you've deflected it is needed for full success.
Right. Franco, do you want to ask your question? That seems like it's a good pickup point here.
Actually, I have a question. And so what type of asteroid, do we know what type of asteroid this pair of asteroids is? And is it related to any meteorites that we might have here on Earth?
Yeah, that's a great question. So what we know about Didymos and Dimorphos is pretty much Didymos, right? I mean, because when you look at this object system, like the amount of signal from Dimorphos is so much smaller than Didymos. Didymos is an S-type asteroid. These are related to ordinary chondrite meteorites. Ordinary chondrite meteorites are the most common type of meteorite to hit the Earth. And so this is perfect for planetary defense, that we're doing the test on an object that's like the most common type that hits the Earth. So this is fabulous. An ordinary chondrite meteorite is something that never fully melted, never made a core and a mantle and a crust. And so it's these 4.5 billion years old. It's got metal and rocking components mixed to each other. It's the leftovers of planet formation. And so it's this fine-grained material all intermixed in the meteorites that we see there. That's for Didymos. And we also know the shape of Didymos because Arecibo actually did observe it in 2003. And so that shape that I'm showing is a little bit of an artistic representation for Didymos, but it's based off the Arecibo shape model. And so it's got sort of that band around the center, very similar to Bennu and Ryugu that were visited by other spacecraft missions. So all of that is about Didymos. So then the question is, okay, but what do we know about Dimorphos? Well, from what we know about how it orbits, all of the models for how this binary asteroid system, this double asteroid system would form, suggest that Dimorphos should have the same material as Didymos. But this is based on the models, so we'll have to go there and see. The models, there's multiple different models out there, but they all predict that Dimorphos should have the same compositional material as Didymos. That will be very interesting to test, and Hera in particular will be able to see if there are compositional difference between those two, and we'll get a little bit of information on it. But it's a bit of an extrapolation. We don't know what Dimorphos looks like. In Arecibo, it was slightly bigger than one pixel. You can model that that light curve, how much the brightness dips, and that gives you some constraint on how the size of Dimorphos is. But the shape, we don't know. The composition, we just kind of, from the models, think it's going to be similar to Didymos. But we'll have to go and see too.
Branko?
Yeah, so my question was, how does the spacecraft know where to hit the asteroid?
It just is going to hit it. It's trying for the center. I mean, it's literally, we don't know what Dimorphos looks like. We have some constraints on its shape from those light curves by how like that graph dips down, you can model. And so we have some idea based on that modeling and on the, 1.5 Arecibo radar pixel. But, asteroids have all sorts of topography and different depressions and everything. And so really it's going at the center of brightness. Okay. And it is only a pixel or two for so long, right? I mean, even like you saw there, even in the images, it's only a few pixels, so it's just really kind of going for the center of brightness of Dimorphos and trying to hit as close to the center of brightness as it possibly can.
Mike Lyons asked a question. So what is the, have you calculated the actual power of the detonation when it hits the asteroid? In like how many tons of TNT? And
yeah, I do. I have to look it up, but it's like 10 times the bolt of lightning. So it's like a lot, but it's not as much as, you would expect. We haven't come up with a good analogy, I suppose, for that yet. But 10 times the bolt of lightning, I suppose, is pretty good. So it's powerful.
Will it utter the word Shazam?
Dolly!
You can't do that in space.
Right. Steve Schreier had another couple of good questions here too. So hypothetically, if a large asteroid that's several kilometers in size is found, could you ramp up DART with enough time? Could you ramp up the size of DART to maybe potentially deflect that? I know it's so hypothetical here that the question is kind of hard to answer, but I mean, could you ramp up something like DART for other things in the future, maybe?
Yeah, for sure. It depends on your warning time. Sorry, was there a warning? Was there like
No, he didn't ask about that. Yeah.
No, so definitely if you needed to do DART in the future, the idea is that you could do something like this if you needed to, but it would depend on the warning time. Okay. So this is one of the ways that this is not like the Hollywood blockbusters, right? You know, it doesn't wait until this thing like is on top of you and then go give it a small nudge. That's not going to cut it, right? The idea is like, you know, giving it a small nudge and that adds up to a change in its position with time such that the Earth and the asteroid aren't on a collision course. So it would have to be, you know, you'd have to do it 5, 10, 15 years in advance. And you don't need to ramp it up. Like DART could still be this little golf cart sized spacecraft. We really think that this is the amount of deflection that you would do on an object sort of this size. It's just that you would want to do it a decade in advance. And that's possible. I mean, when we track these asteroids, once you've found them, we keep track of them and we have a very good idea of where they are on this timescales of decades. So it's sort of like when I say foreseeable future, it generally means about 100 years out and stuff like that. So if we can find these asteroids, which is a really important key part of all of this planetary defense strategy, and keep track of them, we can put ourselves in this position to really have this warning size. And then you can build something like DART and it should go and be able to work. I mean, that said, people are developing other technologies as well. DART really is just the start. It's NASA's first planetary defense technology demonstration mission, but it's probably not going to be the last because there's other technologies that people have suggested for planetary defense. Rather than
I was going to ask you about the gravitational tractor.
Exactly. Yeah, right. So rather than these sort of, there's kind of two schools of things. There's these ones that are like instantaneous events, right? Where you go like DART and it's like you give it a push or you, you know, do something and it's like this instantaneous thing. And then there's these other ones that are more like a slow push, if you will. So this gravity tractor idea. And that's where you just go and you orbit close to it. And sort of you pull it away just from the gravity, the extra gravity of that spacecraft. But this is something, again, that would act over the time scales of decades. You would have to orbit and pull it very slowly. People have talked about ion beams, where you would put some like ion beams on your spacecraft and kind of like fire them at the asteroid for 5, 10, 15, 20 years, you know, which adds up to a big enough change in time. So there's also two differences between deflection and disruption. So everything I've been talking about is deflection, meaning don't make it into a bunch of pieces, just have what you have and move it slightly, right? Like this is the preferred approach. As soon as you start breaking things into lots of different pieces, it's going to be very, you're not really sure how it's going to happen. You're going to have a bunch more pieces. You're going to have a lot more problems. People don't like that solution as much. You want to go with how can we just kind of deflect this slightly, be it with something that's slow, like a gravity tractor, ion beams, or something fast, such as the kinetic impactor or a nuclear weapon, and you know, those sorts of versions rather than disruption.
Just time for a couple more quick questions here. Are there any designs, Alex Kuhn asked this one, are there any designs for spacecraft that could be built and ready to send to move to an asteroid if we needed to?
That's also another important area for planetary defense is, you know, how are you going to have these things ready? You know, right now we're demonstrating this first technology. We're a long way from an operational capability, right? But that is sort of the goal because the Earth has been hit by asteroids for billions of years. It will get hit by asteroids in the future. Hopefully humans will still be around and we'll want to do something about it. So we want to live in this future where operationally we have this capability. Operationally, you don't want to kind of wait till you find it and then like go find somebody to build a spacecraft. You'd want to have it ready. So does that mean having them here on Earth and then you have a launch on demand capability? Or does that mean that you would position them in space and they would kind of be out in space and on their way to go as you needed them? You know, these are two different ways to look at that problem. But, you know, and some people have thought that maybe you should, you know, build your spacecrafts and have them ready at a regular cadence. And if there's nothing threatening or a hazard to send them to, maybe you can go have them do some science or something like that, you know, go investigate an asteroid for scientific purposes rather than to, you know, prevent an impact with the Earth. But and these are all really exciting things to think about. I think it's great that we're starting to live in a world where we've taken the first step. We've launched a spacecraft to potentially develop a technology so Earth isn't hit by asteroids in the future. But it's just the first step, and there's definitely going to be a lot more that happens in the next decades.
Well, I'd say we leave it there. That sounds like a pretty good spot to end it on. Was there any other questions from the panelists? Anything else, guys?
No. I had a related question to your last one, sort of. You know, let's say we have a pretty good idea of what asteroids are around, certainly larger ones, but of course you could get some rogue asteroid coming in from interstellar systems. Mm-hmm. Now, obviously we have some spacecraft available, SpaceX or whatever, that are sort of kind of ready. Would you have any capability, say these navigation devices and cameras, would you have other systems available that would be able to just be put to quick use? Or would you have to start building from whatever point we discovered this object?
Yeah. So there's definitely, I mean, warning time is key. And also, you know, how fast the object going is important. So near Earth asteroids are, we haven't found more than 50% of the population in this few hundred meter size that could cause regional devastation. We know there's 20,000 plus of them, right? Like that's the most important target, right? But things like comets or interstellar objects have a much, much higher speed, right? I mean, and so those are much more challenging to deflect because, you know, when you're deflecting something, it depends on what you bring in relative to it. So that's another challenge in itself. Something like an interstellar object, we wish we had more warning time because scientifically they're fascinating, right? And then they sneak up on us and everybody needs to get their ducks in the row and get what little information that you can, you know, and I just hope we discover more sooner, and with Ruben coming online, hopefully we will. But if one of those was seen coming towards the Earth, you know, your warning time again, you know, goes out the window. I mean, when you start to get to things where you don't have warning time of many years, yet you have to start looking at totally different solutions. You know, disruption becomes something more you would potentially think of, very uncertain, not your strategy of choice, but you know, it's not your choice to get hit by an interstellar object either. So you're kind of in a bad place. But you know, right now we're trying to just do something about like at least the lowest hanging fruit, the threat that we know about, the one that's gonna be inevitable. But once you get that under control, then it'll be like, okay, how much even more for this potentially rare, but potentially extremely devastating, actually extinction level event, you know?
That's kind of why I was asking, if warning time is everything and you're already building some of these pieces that you would need, why not build a few extra to have them available to maximize your warning time?
I mean, at that point, maybe. But I mean, in an interstellar object, I'd still love it if we had 5 years warning time. I mean, I don't see that happening, right? I mean, so we're just right. we're at the wrong order of magnitude for a lot of these. The same things with, you know, new comets, you know, they just sort of appear, you have less than a year, right? I mean, so if you have less than a year, it kind of doesn't matter if I have a camera sitting on the shelf at that point, right? Because you just don't have enough time for your deflection to add up to a big enough change in position for it to be a useful way to potentially prevent that impact with the Earth. And so you'd have to go down to other things. But, you know, and it's also, you know, risk, reward, consequences, investments, it's all taxpayer money at the end of the day. And so you want to be using it in an efficient way, right? You know, and so I think it's great that, you know, we're taking these steps with NASA to do this highly focused, cost-effective mission to demonstrate this one technology on a double asteroid, you know, and take these first steps, but it's not like we're just rolling around in infinite funds either, rightfully so, because there's a lot of other problems in the world that also deserve attention and deserve funds from our country and from our taxpayers. So I think this is a good balance where we're at, but I looked up my number for there. So yeah, 10 tons of TNT for the DART impact.
It's pretty 10
to the 10th joules. Turns out lightning is pretty big. So yeah, anyways, I mean, you can Google, you know, what is that in relative to something? And, you know, it's, I don't know, but yeah, 10 tons of TNT. But if something that was 160 meters hit the Earth, it would be 70 megatons of TNT.
That's crazy.
So wow. There was an event that happened, I don't know, 2 or 3 months ago off the coast of Norway.
Yeah.
Recently. Mm-hmm. And that kind of took everybody by surprise, but it was a very small object, correct?
It was a small object, and actually people were excited about that. It was it definitely was a few meters, but it exercised the warning network for planetary defense because they did find it ahead of time. So a lot of times you don't know something's hit the Earth until your fireball networks detect it, right? It's literally, people are like, I saw this thing go through the sky, right? And that's how you know these events have happened. Like Chelyabinsk, there was no warning, right? And that was a big one. And most other fireballs, they just go through the sky and that's it. And this one, they actually had a few hours ahead of time where they did detect it. They told everybody around the world through the exercising the network that this thing was coming. And so, you know, for example, if this was going to hit over a populated area, they could have told people there that, you know, don't go run to the windows, you know, kind of thing, which is just the sort of warning that you need, right? I mean, if I see a big bright light go across the sky, I'm probably going to go look out the window too.
Right.
But if I knew I wasn't supposed to because it was going to explode in my face, then I wouldn't. I'd go outside first, maybe.
So Dr. Chabot, after, you know, I read that intro of all the amazing things that you've done so far, what happens after you smack the asteroid, the data has been analyzed, all that stuff? What's next for you? What are you gonna go off to? What's your next project?
Well, I'm really excited about the Martian Moons exploration mission. That was the MEGANE instrument that you mentioned there. We're building a gamma ray and neutron spectrometer. This Martian Moons exploration mission is led by the Japanese Space Agency, but it has this NASA instrument on it that we're building. And it is going to go explore the Martian moons. So it's going to be the first mission that's dedicated to explore the moons of Mars, which are the only other moons in the inner solar system. And we have yet to send a spacecraft to know them. We don't know where they came from. They look like trapped asteroids, but their spectral characteristics are totally wrong for being trapped asteroids. And they're in these really regular orbits that don't look like trapped asteroids. They look like maybe a big impact off of Mars. We're not sure. And so the instrument I'm working on is going to help get the composition of what those moons are made of, which will help tell us about its origin. But the whole mission is very exciting. It's got a lot of instruments. It's going to be in the Mars system for 3 years, and then it's going to bring a sample of Phobos, the larger of the Martian moons, to Earth. So it's going to go down, collect samples, and then bring the sample to Earth. So we'll be able to study it. So that's one of the main things I'm looking forward to. I'm also on the BepiColombo mission, which is going to be the second spacecraft to ever orbit the planet Mercury. I worked on the first one, Messenger. So it's really going to be exciting to be going back to Mercury in some ways and, following up on all the science that we weren't able to do with Messenger, but to continue that exploration with BepiColombo. And then who knows, the next planetary defense missions there's just a lot going on in space and in planetary science. And actually earlier today, I was down at the National Academies of Sciences because we unveiled the decadal survey for planetary science today. So if you see Uranus trending on Twitter right here, then you can, that's because they're recommending that for the next flagship mission, which I don't work on personally, but just so much to discover in our solar system, right in our own backyard that we have yet to learn about. So it's a great time.
Well, that's great. Well, thank you for everything. Thank you for your time today. It's great to meet you. It's great to hear this story. I love hearing all the background of this. Thank you for all of that. Don't forget, the next month, Larry Gladney is going to be here from Yale, and he's going to be talking about astronomy in the time domain on May 17th. And we do have the lunar eclipse. If the clear skies will cooperate, that's coming up on May 15th at 10 o'clock. So come on to the observatory for that. So Franco, thank you for booking our great speakers too, Franco. Franco's responsible for a lot of these great speakers lately. So well done, Franco.
It's grateful to come and give us a talk. Thank you.
Yeah, right.
Oh, that's always fun to talk to people who are so interested and really want to hear about these things. So always delighted. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Don't forget September 26th when we get to watch the planetary pinata.
Exactly. I mean, I should say NASA is planning to, you know, have an event, and the images should be shown on NASA TV live. So definitely tune in.
With a planetary camera, I mean, will this look more like a comet on a let's call it maybe a 12 megapixel CMOS?
I don't know how much ejecta we're going to see. I mean, prepare to be underwhelmed potentially, right? I think it still is a golf cart slamming into the Great Pyramid, so we're hoping maybe for a slight brightening of the overall system, and maybe something like Hubble or James Webb Space Telescope will be able to capture some details, but I don't know. I think it'll just at least be able to nice that you'll be able to see where it is and see what you see, but nothing like Shoemaker Levy 9 or anything, you know.
We could probably get the light curve with our own equipment.
Oh, cool. That. Yeah. Well, you should be able to do that. I mean, you know, whatever the precision, we're going to put stuff up on the DART website and everything like that, but that's kind of fun too, to be able to, if you can get it. And then, you know, you have to back out because Didymos is rotating and Dimorphos goes, you know, it gets complicated, but yeah.
You laugh in the face of complication.
It's a you know, the first full scale test of asteroid deflection, so it's worth looking up for, right?
Well, thank you again, Doc. It's such a pleasure, and you know, we'll hopefully get you back, and we talk about next results on some of your other missions. We'd love to have you.
Yeah, no, love to come up there sometime in person too, if it works.
Yeah, we're about 45 minutes north of New York City, so if you're in New York, it's easy. We'll come get you.
Exactly.
Amtrak, baby.
Yeah. All right. Well, we'll talk soon. Thanks, everybody. Thanks for attending tonight. And we'll see you next month. And hopefully we'll see you for the lunar eclipse. Be well.
Good. Thank you. And good night.
Thank you. Great talk.